Hey, it's Terry Dean, and you're listening to the 360 Entrepreneur with Jan Alonga.
This is episode 222, and today is all about storytelling, engagement, and sales. Here we go.
Welcome to the 360 Entrepreneur Podcast, the show for entrepreneurs and small business owners who dream big and want to do bigger. Join some of the world's top entrepreneurs, internet marketers, and best-selling authors as they share their inspiring stories, their struggles, and give actionable tips that will help you build, grow, and promote your online business. Here's your host, Jani Lunga.
Well, hello and welcome to the first episode for August here, Jani Lunga, like always. And I want to start this episode with a question. Do you have an email list? Perhaps you do. Maybe you have one that you consider smaller compared to other people. And how would you like to get more engagement, sales, and overall better results from your list? If you're smiling and you're ready, then you know that you're in the right place. Today's expert, Terry Dean from mymarketingcoach.com, is gonna help you with exactly those things. Increase conversions, getting more engagement, better results, and increase sales from your email list, again, even a small one. The show notes page for today's episode is over at janilunga.com/episode222. Ready to get started and dive into the interview? All right, here's the conversation with Terry Dean from mymarketingcoach.com. Who's here with us is somebody who's been called the grandfather or one of the grandfathers of internet marketing. Over the last 20 years, he has helped thousands of clients set up profitable internet lifestyles in hundreds of different markets. And not only that, he has also helped small businesses and entrepreneurs attract quality clients, spot conversion cracks on their website, and earn big income even from a small email list. Think that he's one of the very first online marketers who has demonstrated the power of email list by generating $96,250,000 from one email. Yes, that's right, one email to his list in front of a live audience. I'm honored and pumped to welcome on the show Terry Dean. Terry, how's it going?
Jan, it is great to be here.
Thank you so much for your time. And just so that I know I get this right, should I call you Terry, Grandpa?
I would much prefer Terry over Grandpa, because even though I've been called one of the grandfathers, one of the grandfathers, that's because I've been online since 1996 now. So we're going on over 21 years now. I'm still only in my 40s. Okay, yeah, so no grandpa.
I had a feeling you would say that. So, Terry, it is then. No, jokes aside, Terry, thank you so much for being here. And I know you have quite the expertise and advice for us here, and I'm really excited about that. And I think the first question is in order here is, in case there is somebody joining us and has no idea what you do, even though I just said it in the intro, could you take a moment to put yourself on the map and share what you do?
Well, what I do now is I basically consult and coach clients in hundreds of different markets. I really work one-on-one with a limited number of clients, and then I have membership programs and products that go out to thousands of people. And I really help them generate more profits in their business, make more money from the email list, and generate targeted traffic that they can transition into subscribers, and then buyers, and then lifelong customers. I mean, I have customers that, well, just as an example, I have several clients who are one-on-one coaching clients, which it's a premium fee to work with me one-on-one, right, that have been with me as clients for more than 10 years.
Wow. Wow. So 10 years in internet years is basically what, 30 years in normal life years?
Well, now you're really going to make me old, since I've been online for 20 years. I'm getting old over here. I'm still healthy, yeah. Okay?
No, you know I'm kidding, Terry. Thank you. Jokes aside, thank you so much for taking a moment to tell us more about what you do. And I know that, I mean, you said it, you work with many different clients, and you have worked with clients from many different markets. So I know you have seen all kinds of situations, all kinds of case studies, businesses, websites. And that's where I want to ask you, or that's what I want to ask you about next. When it comes to landing pages and websites, I know that this is a bit a question where I ask you to generalize things a little, but what would you say are some of the things to think about and do to boost conversions on landing pages and sites?
Okay, well, I'm going to do this as quick as I can here, and that is I want to give you what I call the golden glove, the quickie version of the golden glove.
Love it.
I call it the golden glove because I want you to be able to look at your hand and bring these 5 points back to you at any point in the time. So just look at your hand. These are the five fingers of the golden glove. They are desperate problem, unique promise, overwhelming proof, an irresistible offer, and a reason to act now. Okay, those are the five pieces, and explain each one really quickly. Desperate problem means that you're calling out to a very specific audience and you're mentioning a problem that they have, that they know they have, not just that they have, not that you think that they have, but that they've talked about, you've seen them talk about it on social media, you've seen them mention it, for example, on other people's products. You know that this is a problem that they have. So it's who the audience is and a problem that they have. That needs to be somewhere on your landing page. Next, you have a unique promise, not just a promise, but this is a unique promise. So it's a promise that stands out from what others are saying. There's some extra oomph behind your promise. There's a lot of ways we can do that, and we could spend the whole time just talking about promises if we wanted to, but it needs to be a promise that stands out in some way from the competition. The third piece is what I call overwhelming proof, and that is, how do you prove the promise? Those three pieces, the three P's, go together. You have a problem, you have a promise to help solve that problem, and you have proof that backs it up. This could be testimonials, it could be case studies, it could be your own story, it could be studies. Like, I have a lot of clients who have been in some type of weight loss niche, and a lot of times, besides their testimonials, besides photos and things like that, we'll have scientific studies that relate back to what they're talking about also as proof. Then you have an irresistible offer, which means, what are you going to give them for an action? You're asking them to take an action, very specific action, such as buy your product or opt into your list or subscribe to your podcast. And there's an irresistible offer. There's something that you're promising that they're going to receive for doing the action that you're asking them to take. And then finally, we have a reason to act now, which, for example, if I was running a special on my website, I might say that this sale, I'm sure you've seen this in retail all the time, the sale ends on Friday at midnight. Right. That means you have to take an advantage of it before then. If I don't have a specific deadline, then my reason to act now might simply be pointing back to the problem and how the problem will continue to get worse if you don't take action now. I look for these five pieces, and anytime my client brings me a website, they bring me a website, a landing page, an email, a video, anything that we're using for any type of persuasion, I look at it through the lens of these five fingers. And if it's not converting, if they're having conversion problems, I guarantee it's missing at least one of the five fingers.
Wow, that's powerful. Thank you, Terry, for sharing that with us. So you mentioned desperate problem, unique promise, proof, irresistible offer, and reason to act now. A question I want to ask you, Terry, that it's a follow-up on those 5 points, has to do with the reason to act now. I know that it's relatively easy to apply it when we sell something. So you made the example of retail, which I think is crystal clear. But when it comes to a landing page to generate leads, I think identifying the first 4 points of the golden glove is easy. So the problem, I mean, is easy. Maybe easy isn't the right word, is intuitive. Let's say the problem, the promise, the proof, and offer. But what about reason to act? If the goal of our page is to generate leads, do you have any advice, ideas, or examples of how, if anything, what something we can do to kind of create a sense of urgency, even for those who may be interested in joining our email list?
Okay, so you have an email list. When you ask somebody to join your email list, I'll bump back. These all go together, but I'll bump back to the irresistible offer. When you ask somebody to join your email list, you should be giving them something of value. Okay. Right. And that means it could be a video, it could be a PDF cheat sheet, it could be an audio from your best podcast interview that's going to give them this benefit, this benefit, and this benefit. So you're giving them something of value. The reason to act now you know, sometimes it can be a deadline, such as this is a test. You don't know how long you're going to give this away, which I have done that when we're doing like a big promotion. I'll give away a special freebie that sometimes I might even be selling. I might pull like one of the bonuses from one of my products and give that away and only do it for a limited time. And so if my goal is to get the absolute best conversion from something I'm running something special for, okay, I will do something like that, which gives me a very good reason to act now. But let's say it's the opt-in that's on your website that it's going to be on your website pretty much all the time. Okay, with that, a lot of times what I've tested and found for opt-in gifts is that the reason to act now kind of comes back to the speed that they can use the information you give them. So I specifically like to look for something in your offer that they can get results from fast, which I can kind of tie back into reason to act now. So in other words, they can immediately take and use one of these subjects. Okay, I'll use an example from my own because, hey, I like promoting my own site.
Right.
And that is at mymarketingcoach.com. I give away a free email conversion kit to help you generate better conversions. Okay. And one of the cheat sheets that comes with that is 64 story starters, which the 64 story starters basically give you 64 questions to ask yourself to come up with ideas for story-based emails, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. And with the 64 questions, so one of the ways I can tell you a reason to act now is, you know, quit worrying about trying to come up with all the ideas you need for your emails. All you need to do is just grab my cheat sheet that shows you 64 story starters, go through it, and you will come up with half a dozen or even a dozen ideas within the next 10 minutes for emails that you could write. See, I didn't actually say, hey, you had to do it now, but I told you how fast you could get results from that. That's a reason to act now. Okay. And I always look for that. It's kind of funny. Again, I've done this so long, and you see like the markets go through phases. Okay, so there was a point in time where I gave away like these really long ebooks as my free gift for people to opt in. Mm-hmm. That worked for a while. Now, most of my clients either give away like a short video, that's 5 to 10 minutes as their gift, or we give away even a cheat sheet or a video with a cheat sheet. The cheat sheet may be like 1 or 2 pages long. It's basically because we want to give our prospects something that they can get results from fast. Everyone's overwhelmed with content in pretty much every market, so you're going to get the best results often from a quickie solution. So even if it's a little bit bigger gift like I have, like I actually give people a copy of one of my print newsletters, I also give several cheat sheets so then I can highlight those cheat sheets separately at times because people want the cheat sheets. They want that fast results.
Okay. Thank you, Terry. I think what you shared with us actually makes perfect sense. And as you said, we can utilize the offer we make or the lead magnet we offer as the kind of basically the reason to act now is counterintuitive or implicit, and it is within the lead magnet itself. So you mentioned in your case the 64 or the cheat sheet with the 64 kind of story ideas. That is something that, as you well said, if you know, if somebody's like, yeah, I'm having a tough time coming up with ideas for content for my email lists and stories and things like that, comes across a resource like yours, is one feels like, yeah, I want this right now so that I can immediately come up at least with a few ideas. So thank you for sharing that. I think when it comes to email list, I said you've been doing quite many different things, and one of them is not only you talk about how to grow an email list, but how to grow it in quality and how to get results even from quote-unquote small email lists. So, Terry, what do you think are the key elements for being successful at turning email subscribers into actual paying customers?
Well, one of the first aspects is to know who your customer is, to know who your ideal avatar is. And that's like a first question that I always ask anywhere whenever I'm dealing with any type of traffic or anyone that I'm working with such as a client, is I ask them, describe your client for me. It's basically a process. They come up and they say, hey, can you review my website? Yes, I can. Can you please describe your client for me? That's the first response always.
Right.
And the reason you want to do that first is if you can name off who your ideal client is, we can specifically go after them. We can start thinking about, you know, what is it that you have in common with them that we can share in your email list? What is it that your audience is worried about? What are their worries? What are their interests? What are their likes? What are their dislikes? This becomes important because I do what I call a little bit of repulsion marketing also. Okay, and repulsion marketing means that I like to first magnetically attract the right clients to me, but I want to repel the wrong clients.
Right.
And since I deal with online businesses primarily, I also deal with some brick and mortar businesses as well, but I deal primarily with online businesses, both beginners and advanced marketers. In my markets, there are some people out there, there's some gurus out there who teach this kind of thing, and there's some people out here who believe that they can succeed without doing very much work. Okay, they think that they could just push a few buttons and succeed. Well, I can't help that person until they fix that thinking. So part of my marketing is to repel those people. So in my emails, I'm specifically talking about subjects, and even as I'm sharing here, you can see I try to share a lot of, you know, systems that you can use, and even there, you notice I just repelled. If there's people listening to your podcast who have that attitude that they can get really quick results, they've now been repelled by me.
Right.
They might not listen anymore after this. It's going on even while we're doing this. I do that in my emails all the time. I will constantly talk about the fact that you're going to have to do a ton of work in the beginning. You have to build up the momentum. An online business is kind of like a train. It takes a lot of power to get the thing started, but then it could provide an internet lifestyle for you going forward. It's like you mentioned at the beginning, I'm big on the internet lifestyle. People have to know that internet lifestyle means work first, then build something that survives long term for you.
Right.
And you can tone back what you do. So you do that first, and part of your marketing when you're going out and doing the marketing is you know who you're going after. So any type of advertising that I do both paid advertising, I do content marketing, I do interviews, I do videos. There's a lot of different things that I do to attract traffic. I'm constantly talking, like just like I'm talking to you here, you know, pulling the people who are going to identify with me and repelling the ones who aren't going to identify with me, which means my list is going to be mostly built up, especially over the long term, of people who have similar thinking patterns as I do about these kinds of subjects. And then with a small, when I say that you can make profits from small lists, I mean, I have clients who, one of my clients emailed me not too long ago. He's obviously on the beginner side, and he has less than 100 people on his list because he just started up. We got a couple of videos up for him, and he got 100 people. And he sent an email, and he got 3 sales for an affiliate program.
Wow.
He was extremely excited, okay? If I sent out an email and only got 3 sales, I'd be upset, of course, because my list is much larger than that. I've been around a long time. But he's excited about that because he just got started. He got his first 3 sales from an affiliate program without any product yet. And that's because what he did when he sent out the email, and this kind of tells you for other emails as well, is he's targeting the right people first. The second thing he did was he sent out an email where he had actually purchased the product that he promoted, and the email he sent out was telling him the results he got. So I tried this product, and here's what it did for me. Okay, and that type of a case study story, again, bringing in stories for your emails, case study story, is going to be, it's going to produce the highest level of sales you get when you're promoting affiliate programs. It's because you did a case study story, and then you can use that same principle in your own business. For example, I regularly tell case studies of some of my clients, the results that some of my clients are getting, or that I'll tell things that I'm doing and going on. The biggest mistake that people make with email is they send out what I call constipated content. Constipated content is content and tips without a story attached, without a personal relationship attached. Fix that, and you fix most of your email problems.
Nice. I like that. So would you say, Terry, that in that case, there is also like a lack of context in a way for sending that specific email?
There is. See, the big problem, a lot of people will say for the affiliate programs, they'll send out the email the affiliate program gave them. If all affiliate programs are usually going to have, here's our recommended email.
Right.
Never, ever send the recommended email to your list, because that's the email everybody else is sending, and it has no relationship to you. It's just a piece of an email in the middle of space. The most important aspect of your email list is not the subject line. The most important aspect is that from address, and that you've built in a relationship with them. Okay, that they make a connection with you. They see your name, and they have feelings attached to the fact that you've sent them emails over time. Like, again, I'll mention back, this shocked me the first time I ever spoke at conferences, but I spoke at an internet conference, this is more than a decade ago, but one of the people came up to me and brought me a binder of emails he'd been saving. He'd actually been saving my emails in a binder, and he asked me to sign that for him, like authors sign books. I didn't have my own book at the time. And so he asked me to sign his binder of emails, and he told me he had printed them out and taken them across the street to the park and read them each time I sent him one of the emails. Okay, that's, of course, not everybody in your list is going to do that. You're going to have, even with small list, you might build up 1,000 people on the list, maybe 100 of them become buyers at some point, the other 900 aren't buyers. Okay, but that those people who make that connection with you, the whole point here is you're writing the emails for that percentage that will say, everybody talks about 80-20 rule. You're writing for the 20% who are actually going to stick with you long-term that you can build a relationship with. Everything you do, all the stories that you talk about, your own personal life, you're going to mix that in with everything you do with email because it should be a relationship. They should feel like they know you.
Well, Terry, from what you just said, it really sounds that everybody who's here with you and I should head over to the show notes page for today's episode, where they're going to find the link to the page you mentioned where they can sign up for your checklist and the story ideas. Because, I mean, you said it, story, it's something that really makes a difference. I mean, the example you just shared of that person at the conference asking you to sign the emails is proof that person was really kind of touched not only by the content you shared, but also by how you went about sharing the content.
They really are. And it's really, think of it this way. I'm sure most of your audience has heard this before. People buy based on emotion and they justify it with logic. They also, any relationship you have is going to be based to a point on emotion also. That's what we're talking about here is when they get your email in their inbox, what emotions have they attached to you so far? And that's what I'm doing with emails, is I'm continually sending emotions. I'm not just sending emails, I'm sending out emotions to my list. It might be at one point I might rant about something. I might be angry about something in the market. That's an angry emotion, okay? Other time, I might be, like, I sent out a sad email. I didn't promote anything in this email. I just sent it out, telling the fact that when my dog died, my assistant in the office, and how upset I was. And okay, I'm letting my emotions show here. I actually cried when I was writing the email, okay, when I wrote it out for that. I sent that to my list also, and that makes a connection. Didn't make any sales from, because I wasn't trying to sell that day, but it's just part letting them into your life, especially as it relates to the business. The dog was part of my business because, hey, I work at home, so he was my closest, you know, working assistant right here. And so it just becomes a part of who you are. It's like an ongoing, we could almost call it like you're an ongoing TV character here that's also sharing content and value. And as I'm saying this, don't think at any point in time it's about you. It's really about the audience. Mm-hmm. And you're just mixing in value the same way. Even here, you notice when I was talking about the email and sending out story-based emails, I then mentioned the conference. I just naturally bring in a story. And as you do this in your emails, it ends up coming up in everything else you do as well.
Yeah, exactly. And Terry, I'm sorry about your dog, but I thank you for sharing that example with us, because I think it's something that hits home with many people. So it's clear, as you said, that the emotion we manage to transfer or make people feel is key. And how do we go about kind of, I don't know if fascinating is the right word, but if we have people who are just joining our email list, do you have any advice on maybe something we can do to have them go from subscriber to buyers in a relatively short period of time?
Yes, I have a pretty I have a system that my clients and I use pretty much all the time now at the very beginning of a sequence. And what that is the very first email that you send out is going to be, it's going to be a set autoresponder message that when somebody subscribes, you're going to email them over whatever free gift you promised, the free bribe, the lead magnet that you promised them. Right. That's in the first email. In addition, I email over usually like a bullet list of some of the benefits they're going to get in future emails. So some of the content I'll be talking about there, basically I'm reselling them on staying a member of the list. Mm-hmm. And then when we deliver the freebie, almost always I'll have a client have a link directly over to like a low-end sales page. So something they're selling that's low-end, like a $10 product or a $20 product or a $50 product that's linked to right underneath whatever the free gift that we're providing them with. And on my system, it actually works like this. Somebody opts in, and the moment, the thank you page, they'll see at the top of the page, it tells you to go check your email and confirm your email address. And I even tell you what it's going to look like. Here's what the subject's going to look like. And I take an image of what it's going to look like in your Gmail box or any other box. And, you know, go confirm. But before you do, it may take a couple of minutes for you to receive your free gift. Check out this offer. And right below that, I have a simple offer. It's a low-cost offer, and it has a little video presentation that goes with it as well. So I'm making a sale right there, and it surprises people that I go for a sale very quickly like this. But mm-hmm. I found that if you can get people to make a subscriber decision and then a purchasing decision very quickly like this, they become much better long-term customers. And a lot of my clients are surprised, but I have a lot of clients who we do some big paid advertising campaigns. I mean, I have clients who we start at $5 a day on ads. I have other clients who we do $100,000 a month on advertising, okay, that we're bringing clients in with. Mm-hmm. And we, in many cases, those big campaigns, we're generating somewhere between 30 and 50% of their front-end sales, the sales of that first product, within the first 24 to 48 hours. Okay, wow. With the system. And then, like, the second email you sent, I always like to do an origin story. I'm big on origin stories. I'm big on stories. And the origin story is simply, why are you in the business you're in? What got you started in this business? And I always want that to be at least one of the first couple of autoresponder messages that's sent out to a new subscriber. Why do you do what you do? What motivated you to do it? What moved you to this direction? What problem did you have? What space did you see in the marketplace? But why do you do what you do? We do that origin story at least like the second or third email almost all the time. That also helps generate sales quickly because it makes that connection. And if I tell you my origin story of why I do what I do, that also tells you a little bit about what makes me different from my competitors.
Right. Yeah, actually, that's a very good point that you just touched upon, Terry. I think it's important to keep that into consideration. And it ties into what you were talking about early on when you said that, for example, you sharing the passing of or passing away of your dog, it's something that in a way helps people get to know a little bit more about you as a person. But then you said it is not really about you, it's about them. And I'm curious, Terry, when it comes to this strategy you just shared, I've seen quite many people, and I'm sure you have seen too, who have low entry offers and things like that. Some, I don't know, depending on how priced the product is, it could be some pretty low price. Would you say that it's something that can contribute to higher conversions, like have an introductory offer that is available only, let's say, only for the next couple of hours or something like that, or not necessarily?
Definitely. It definitely can, having an offer like that. I mean, it's not on mine. I feel it's a little too high pressure for my own list, but I have mm-hmm. a couple of clients where we've even put a countdown timer on the thank you page for the offer. So depending on your market, depending on your audience, you can definitely even do like a countdown timer, go for something low cost. And I mean, it could be like one client. This is just gives you another strategy. One client with his, we're generating like 40 to 50% of his sales in the first 48 hours. What we do with on his program is he's selling a little bit higher end course that costs $199. But what we do is you can try it out for the first 10 days for $1. So you pay $1 okay. today, you to try it out for 10 days. And then there's two monthly payments of $99. We're very clear about that on the sales page. It's $1, two payments of $99 afterwards. You know, so nothing's hidden. You know that it's $199. We tell you that it is, but you get to try it out for $1 today. And if you don't like it, let us know within 10 days and you will not be billed anything else for it. And that's very effective in his system.
Yeah, actually, that's a very good one. I've seen a few people do something similar, maybe, for example, with membership sites or things like that, where they may have a similar offer. It's definitely, it's nice. This conversation we're having, Terry, I think it's good because you're providing us with not only your advice, but also some examples of different things that then we can test out and see which ones or one works best for us. And we've talked about email list. First of all, we talked about landing pages a little bit, and then you told us some things we can do when it comes to our email list. So things we can do to boost engagement and turn subscribers into buyers. What about our content? So you said that content marketing is also something you talk about. So it isn't just possible to monetize through email list. It is also possible to actually leverage content marketing to generate sales. So do you have any advice on what to think about and do in order to do that?
Well, see, since I started with email, that's where my first focus was on email and learning the systems I've talked about here. Mm-hmm. But you can apply these same systems to anything else. Like, I'm talking a lot about stories for emails. Back when I did some speaking, one of the people I spoke for, he wanted me to go through a speaking course. I guess that doesn't say a whole lot for my speaking ability at the time. But one of the things in the speaking course that it taught me most specifically was how every point you share need to have a little story or illustration behind it. So if you had 3 points in your speech, you need to have at least 3 stories or 3 illustrations or more. And so you notice how that's fitting the same thing I do for email as well, for doing when somebody's speaking. So now you notice I mention stories, examples, as we're doing this podcast right here. So in the podcast, I'm doing the same model that I do with email. I'll do a video and often like do a very short video. So a lot of times my videos, they're about the same length if you pulled out a transcript of them. So like 4, 5, 6 minutes, about the same length as my emails would be. And I'm doing the same thing, which is I actually have a think of my content model almost like this. My content model is entertain, educate, earn. I do this for emails. I do this for anything else, which means I want to do something that's entertaining. And since I don't tell jokes, I'm not a person, a stand-up comedian, I'm not good at that. I do tell stories, and I try to have a little fun in some of the stories. So I always think, okay, how can I have a story, have something that's fun? I want to have fun while I'm doing it. And even like one of my testimonials from a client says that he likes work with me, not just because I help make his business successful, but I'm someone who likes to have fun with him. And that was important too. And so you have fun first with whatever you're doing. If you're not having fun producing the content, no one's having fun listening to it. Okay, keep that in mind. Yeah. And the next piece is you have to educate. There has to be value here. It's not just telling stories about you. It's stories that help people. It's giving value. There's a tip hidden in every one of these stories. If I went back to when I was a kid watching cartoons, they always said the moral of the story is. And so the tip from this story is, that's the educate part. And then earn, there's always a connection to something you offer. There's always a connection to something you do. And I kind of brought it in earlier because you asked for an example for me to give, and that was like my email list that I had over at mymarketingcoach.com. I brought it in early because you asked for an example, but that would have came up somewhere in the conversation otherwise as well. So they're always doing something. And you notice here, it's not a pitch. Don't do a hard pitch. You don't have to do hard pitches. You just, if you give people a story, you make a connection, you give them value, all you really have to do is mention in the content what you have to offer. Mention the next level, how they can take the next step to you, and they're going to be motivated to go forward. You don't have to do a pitch. You don't have to do any hard selling or anything of that nature. Just entertain, give good content, and then always mention it. And don't make the mistake some people do where they're shy about mentioning the products. I believe in what I do. I believe in the emails I send out. I believe in the products that I sell and the services that I offer. So I'm not shy about telling people that if you fit my ideal client profile, you should be on my list. You should buy my products, but I'm not going to sit here and pitch them to you.
Yeah, I think what you just said, Terry, makes perfect sense. And I think that personally, if you have something, you know, whether it's a product or services or anything like that, and you are communicating in some way with somebody who could benefit from it, and you don't even mention it because you're shy, you're actually doing them a disservice in a way. Would you agree?
You are, because you shouldn't be selling a product if you don't believe in it.
Right.
And if you believe in it, then why in the world aren't you telling people about it?
Yeah, exactly. And Terry, I think you may have noticed that I've been having a great time chatting with you. Not only the content has been fantastic and your insight, but also the way you went about it. I had a very good time during this interview. So first of all, I want to remind everybody again that in the show notes page, you're going to find the links to Terry's site, mymarketingcoach.com, and everything else we've covered in the show notes page. And Terry, if somebody would like to connect with you or maybe to ask you a question or anything like that, what would you say is the best way to do that?
The best way to do it? Sounds a little self-serving. Is actually to go over to the page, subscribe to the list, and as soon as you get an email, reply to it, because I read every email that comes in. I don't necessarily read everything on other things, but every reply to my emails, I'm not one of the big companies that, hey, sends out emails and it goes to don't reply to this email. I reply to my emails. I want to get your emails, and I tell every one of my clients the same.
Great. So You heard it. If you want to learn from Terry, communicate with him, connect with him, the best way to do that is to actually go to the show notes page for this episode, and you're going to find the way to do that and join his email list. And Terry, again, this has been a fun interview. Thank you so much for your time and expertise and for sharing everything with us here.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad to be here and had a lot of fun.
Great. And to wrap it up, I have a final question for you. Is there anything you would like to add, maybe something we forgot to touch upon or something you would like to double down on when it comes to everything we have covered today?
I just want to tell everyone that no matter where you are in your journey, that this is something you do if you have faith. One of the things that I found in business is that you can't predict how long it takes to succeed. And we kind of joke around, some of my friends and I joke around, that however long you think it's going to take 2 to 3 times longer.
Right. That's true.
That's the plan. It's going to take 2 to 3 times longer. But I don't play 9-inning baseball games. I play till I win.
Right.
Okay. And you can do the same thing. If you build a relationship with a list, if you target a list, you're going to make some mistakes. You're going to fall down. One of the reasons I love email so much is I still, to this day, send out some emails that don't work that well, that don't generate sales from that email. Okay. If I send an email and it doesn't work great, then all I think to my mind now is, well, that didn't work. I'll try again tomorrow.
Right.
For another one. So we get to try again. You get another try because you're giving content value. You're building a relationship. So you can do this. If I can do it, you can do it. Just be willing to put in the time and the effort to make it happen.
Amen. Very powerful words to end up today's episode. And we are back. You heard it. There is so much you can do right now to really turn your email marketing efforts around and get results, grow your business. Even, and I want to stress this once again, even if you consider your email list to be a small one. Terry and I talked about a few things, and during the interview, we mentioned a free resource he has with several stories, conversation starters you can use. If you want to get that, check out the show notes page for today's episode. I've linked to that there. yanilunga.com/episode222. Before I let you go, a quick sneak peek about next week's episode. If you have a podcast, it doesn't matter what type of podcast, next week's episode is something you don't want to miss out on, because we're going to talk about iTunes SEO. So if you have a podcast, then you know that iTunes is the number one platform. And if up until now you had no idea in terms of what you can do to optimize your podcast content for iTunes, you're going to get some answers in next week's episode. And I'm talking about specific things you can do, tweaks so that your podcast increases its rankings on iTunes.
Thank you for listening to the 360 Entrepreneur Podcast. For more tips and tools, head over to www.yanilunga.com.